man, I'm basically going to recap what happened. Last time we had Grandmaster DXT, pioneering DJ, on the show, and I asked him a question about the Herbie Hancock video, Rocket. And, you know, I asked him, you know, it was weird because, you know, the whole video, it was all like robots and stuff, and you only saw Herbie, you only saw his hands a couple of times, and you only saw him on a monitor a couple of times. And I asked him why, you know, he wasn't in the video and why Herbie wasn't in the video that much. And DXT said, well, they didn't play black people on MTV in 1983. We heard this before. Pat, you brought it up. You also sent me a clip, which we're going to play after a little bit, of David Bowie actually being interviewed by Mark Goodman on MTV in 1983, pretty much saying the same stuff that DXT was saying. Well, anyway, Digital Music News, you know, shout out to them. They picked up the story. They ran a story on it. Actually the co-founder, one of the co-founders of MTV himself, Les Garland, he actually wrote a letter into Digital Music News. And I'm going to read that letter real quick. It says, to whom it concerns, I am responding to the piece that appeared in July 12th edition written by Daniel Adrian Sanchez. Did MTV refuse to air black musicians in the 80s? The answer to this radical headline is no, MTV did not refuse to air black musicians. That is a serious non-factual accusation that's been refuted for decades. Simple fact-checking would reveal that Herbie Hancock's Rocket was a huge award-winning song, and music video recognized it with 5 MTV Video Music Awards along with a Grammy. Another thing, my friend Rick James did not sue MTV. Lastly, Viacom had nothing to do with MTV in 1983. Using today's jargon, Mr. Sanchez, I'd have to say your article is fake news. I'm sorry, Mr. Grandmaster DXT. Your allegations are not accurate or truthful. Warm regards, Les Garland, MTV co-founder, senior executive. Now, I also, before we bring on DXT, I also reached out to Les Garland himself. His people did get back to me. He says he couldn't make it, and he wishes us to have a wonderful show. But he couldn't make it. But
of course he couldn't make it.
He's here. Let's bring him on and hear what his response is to Les Garland's statement to Digital Music News. DXT, first and foremost, how are you doing, man?
I'm good, brother. I'm good. How are y'all?
Glad to hear that. Welcome back to the show. As you just heard what I read from Les Garland, co-founder of MTV, were you contacted by MTV yourself at all after this, or?
No. That was... It's very interesting because the next day after I did that interview, I just so happened to be on the web and I saw a new listing of stuff with my name in it the very next day, like not even 24 hours later, and I saw the article that the journalist wrote. And I went, wow, okay. Took that one segment of what we were discussing and he did an article on it. And he interjected his own spin on it. And I initially had an issue with that. But I said, okay, you know, he's going to take it and run with it and see what he can generate with that. And it worked because it definitely got all the way back to MTV. And they responded. And I think, you know, it's a legitimate response. But it speaks to what we were talking about, how, you know, history is skewed by this behavior. And no, they did not contact me. And that was the only contact that I got by running into it myself. And as you can see, the gentleman Les, I was not, if y'all remember the conversation, I wasn't attacking, the show wasn't about MTV. I was talking about my experience with Rocket and what happened with the video. And I easily remember I said, now think about this. It could have been football, baseball, basketball, or art, or anything. But that the behavior, the mindset of the social system skewed the history based on the color of our skin. And that's real. And unfortunately, one of the problems is the less, what's his last name, Garland?
Yeah.
What's his name? Les Garland.
Yeah, Les Garland.
Yeah, he you know, I wasn't attacking him either. But the point is, him to respond and not acknowledge what actually happened in the history that was skewed, you know, it makes it crazy. Because he's not owning up to the reality of our experience, which goes to show he did not experience what we experienced of color. He didn't experience that. He doesn't think about it. He doesn't walk out of his house and have to go through that. You see what I'm saying? And so he doesn't see it the way we see it. And that's where the conversation is. That's where a conversation is necessary, because for him to respond that way. And I take full responsibility for the Rick James statement, because I should have researched that even more. The narrative through all these years was he sued them. He threatened to sue them. And so he didn't actually sue them. He threatened. So I'll take responsibility for saying that he sued them. But he didn't. But that's the only thing that wasn't truthful. And he used the term. He's very clever. He used truthful. Not truthful. Not that the whole shit's a lie. He said not truthful. But we can fix that by removing the Rick James thing out of it. And that's the full part. And so we're just left with the truth. And the truth is that during that time, we actually did the research. The first day of MTV, not one black artist appeared on the channel. The only black person that on the first day was a musician in one of the bands. One guy. And so, it's not even a debatable thing. It's an unfortunate, his response is unfortunate. Because MTV did great things once they over that hump of that mindset. Because it's not the music that did that. That's the way people are functioning and thinking is what created the problem. And once that problem was, what the motivation was to change that, we can all probably think that it was just money, but it changed. And MTV became one of the great platforms for the hip-hop movement. You know, and so I don't hold no grudge against MTV. That was not the reason why I said what I said. It was about the behavior and the consciousness of how people were functioning based on the color of people's skin. And it's insanity. And his response to it shows clearly that, you know, it hasn't ended, because he completely is in denial of the reality of the situation.
Exactly. And like we were talking about at the beginning of this show, we're actually going to go to this clip right now. It's from 1983. It's actually from MTV. It's a clip of David Bowie being interviewed by Mark Goodman. And David Bowie was asking the question of, why aren't there more black artists being played on MTV? Let's go to this clip, and then I want to, just for listeners that haven't heard it, then I want to get your thoughts about it. We'll be right back.
I'd like to ask you something. It occurred to me, having watched MTV over the last few months, that it's a solid enterprise, and it's got a lot going for it. I'm just floored by the fact that there's so few black artists featured on it. Why is that?
I think that we're trying to move in that direction. We want to play artists that seem to be doing music that fits into what we want to play for MTV. The company is thinking in terms of narrow casting.
That's evident. It's evident in the fact that the only few black artists that one does see are on about 2:30 in the morning or to around 6. Very few are featured predominantly during the day.
No, that's a...
I'll say that over the last couple of weeks these things have been changing, but it's a slow process.
I know, it's funny, I think people have different perceptions. When you wind up watching, let's say you watch an hour or two or even three a day, people somehow come away with different ideas about what we are doing. We don't have any kind of day parting for anything, let alone a black artist day parted out of what would be, quote, prime time. We don't have that.
Because one sees a lot on the there's a one black station on television that I keep picking up. I'm not sure which station it's on, but there seem to be a lot of black artists making very good videos that I'm surprised aren't used on MTV.
Well, of course, also we have to try and do what we think not only New York and Los Angeles will appreciate, but also Poughkeepsie or Midwest. Pick some town in the Midwest that will be scared to death by Prince, which we're playing. Or a string of other black faces.
That's
and black
very
music.
Interesting. Isn't that interesting?
You know, we have to play the music that we think an entire country is going to like. And certainly, we're a rock and roll station now. The question would be asked: well, should since we're in New York, should PLJ play, the Isley Brothers? Well, you and I might say yeah, because we have grown up in an era when the Isley Brothers mean something to me, and so do the Spinners. Even way after the Isley Brothers. But what does it mean to a 17-year-old? Well, if you talk on the phones to these guys like I did when I was in radio, it's
well,
scary.
I'll tell you what it means. I'll tell you what maybe the Isley Brothers or Marvin Gaye means to a black 17-year-old.
Ah.
And surely he's part of America as well.
No question. No question. And that's why you're seeing those things.
Do you not find that it's a frightening predicament to be in?
Yeah, but less so here than in radio.
And is it not? Well, no, don't say, well, it's not me, it's them. Is it not possible that it should be a conviction of the station and of other radio stations? To be fair, it does seem to be rampant through American media. Should it not be a challenge to try and make the media far more integrated in those in music,
happening.
Especially of anything in musical terms?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, I think it's happening because white music and white musicians are now starting to play more than ever, more than they have lately, let's say, in the last 10 years.
Yeah.
What black artists have been into. Mm-hmm. And now, hopefully, the lines are going to start to blur. And when we play a band like ABC,
yeah,
well, there's white and black kids who are enjoying it. And all of a sudden, well, it's a little bit easier for a white kid to understand it.
Now, I want to point out two things real quick. First and foremost, what Mark Goodman said was we're a rock and roll station. First off, those of you on the phone know rock and roll is created by black musicians in the South, pretty much. So if you're a rock and roll station, you should have no problem playing black artists, because that's truly black music. And second, I want to point out what David Bowie said, who's a white artist who saw the same thing that you were talking about at the time. He pointed out, well, the Isley Brothers would matter to a 17-year-old black kid. And that was the whole point. It's like you want to get all the audiences involved in this. You want to be able to have something for everybody. I think that's what David Bowie was touching on. When you hear that clip, DXT, what are your thoughts on that, what David Bowie was trying to bring up back then?
Well, I personally think that clip, that interview, is a case study. If you listen closely to that, you will hear sheer unadulterated insanity expressed as sanity. And it's scary because what he was saying, you have to look at that through a worldview that suggests that someone is superior and someone is inferior. If you study what he's saying, he doesn't even realize what he's saying. And to suggest that, you know, white people will be afraid of Prince and not afraid of Kiss, I don't get that. It's music. Why is there a line? How do you segregate melody, rhythm?
Yeah, it's universal language, yeah.
Yeah, how is
crazy?
Doing
why would this scare kids in the Midwest? You know,
right.
Or wherever the hell.
But if you check out that interview, it should be studied by, you know, sociologists and doctors, that what this man is saying. It's insane. But he, in his mind, through his worldview, it's real. He made absolutely no sense. But to a lot of people, he does. But if you remove, if you bring it back to human beings functioning like human beings, that was an insane interview. And David Bowie, I take my hat off to him, bless his heart, for even attempting to raise that issue. And he even met the guy at the gate. Every time he thought he was through the gate, he met him there and saying, okay, well, what you think, you know, the music, like people want to hear music. Don't you think a 17-year-old black person would like to hear Prince or, who, you know, a black artist on, like, what are you saying? What are you saying? You know?
Yeah.
And it's incredible. It's incredible that that conversation actually happened, and it's looked at as a sane conversation when in actuality it's an insanity. Like, what he's saying
is
nuts. Don't you think? It's nuts.
You can't rationalize that way of thinking, you know.
No, it makes no sense.
None at all. None at all.
No.
And David Bowie, you know, he was very much like yourself, pointing out, you know, saying truth. I mean, you know.
Right.
And this was his. This is one of the biggest rock and roll stars of all time. You know,
right.
Saying this in the early '80s. You know, from a different country. He wasn't a black artist. He was a white artist from a different country, and he's seen it.
Right.
You know.
Exactly.
It says a lot about America, too.
And, right. And what's crazy, though, Prez, is, you know, when we was young, man, we was a little young when MTV first came out. So it's like they try to erase history, like, and think people can't actually sit back and remember. I remember being young and not seeing any black videos on MTV. You know what I'm saying? Like, and we always wondered about it, but and for them to try to say that they wasn't discriminating, it's still people around that can remember that shit, man.
Yeah, here's what's interesting. Remember, the ratings are based on the viewers. And so, you know, we all watched MTV, you know. So a lot of their ratings came from a diverse community of people, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Right.
And so, like, that helped them, you know, and for them to, and you know they know that, but instead of them saying, hey, you know, this community is watching, that community is watching, music is universal. And for him to say white artists, black music, white, there's really no such thing. You see what I'm saying? And so that, for like, again, man, I would like to listen to. I'm gonna go back and listen to that and just study it, man, to understand.
Yeah, it's crazy.
How is his brain processing what he's saying to David Bowie? Is amazing to even think.
Yeah, because there's no, not to cut you off, DFC, but there's, like you just said, there's no boundaries of who can listen to rock or heavy metal, or who can listen to rap or disco, or who can listen to the blues or opera. There's anybody can listen to anything. Music is a universal language at all levels. You know what I'm saying? And for a dude to dissect it like or put it like that, it's kind of disturbing.
Because we're looking at it through a universal lens. He's not.
Yeah.
He's looking at it through a European worldview that is its foundation is based on white supremacy. And he doesn't realize that that behavior doesn't only damage people of color, it damages everybody. Because everybody suffers when you skew history. Everybody. You know,
yeah.
And that's what the point was, you know. And so, and that's why I said it's a study, because you can see, listen to what he's saying. He is dealing with this from a worldview that is shaped around his idea of being supreme and powerful, and how he sees it is the way it should be seen. And that's why he's talking that way. Like, this is what it is. Like, and he's very clear. He said it clear as day, you know. White people in Middle America, they don't want to see that. They're going to be terrified of seeing Prince. Like, that's insane. You know, it's insane, man. You know?
Oh, yeah.
And so...
And when you look at the interview, not to cut you off, but when you look at the interview and you look at the response and the look on Bowie's face, he's almost, like, shocked. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's a couple times he didn't really know what to say, but then he's like, well, what about this? And he hit him with that thing about the 17-year-old black kid would like to hear the Isley Brothers. And, I don't know, it's crazy. You're right, man. People need to go back and really study that. But the clip that was sent to me, it was actually, Brandon, you sent it to me. It was on the MTV YouTube page.
I just found something though, Prez. I just found something, and there's a Les Garland quote in it, and like, it's pretty much talking about like how they didn't play many black artists, and it said Andrew Goodwin later wrote, "MTV denied racism on the grounds that it merely followed the rules of the rock business," which the writer of the story writes, which were nonetheless the consequence of a long history of racism. MTV senior executive vice president Les Garland complained decades later, "The worst thing was that racism bullshit. There were hardly any videos being made by black artists." And then he backed that up by saying record companies weren't funding them. They never got charged with racism. So what he's saying is, back then, MTV didn't have access to black artists with music videos. But while
said there was.
Yeah, like, while he was saying this, like, that was during the time of the whole Rick James thing, and it was also during the time when the whole Michael Jackson thing was going on, because they weren't playing Billie Jean and Beat It, because they were initially rejected by MTV.
Right.
So it's something that Les Garland kind of talks about a lot.
What article is this from, Ed?
It's from Elcatron.com, but it's like a whole, there's like a bunch of different things in it. Like, they talk about MTV, they talk about, they talk about all kinds of stuff, like wrestling. There's all kinds of different stories in here, BET, Spike TV, Comedy Central. I'll send you the link to it now, man.
Okay. I was really hoping Les would have called in, because I really think Les and DXT need to talk. Would you be willing to sit down and talk to him? Because it seems
you could
really shed a lot of light to him, because obviously, you know, I don't know, man. It's almost like, to me, it almost looks like there's a lot of denial going on when there's so much evidence pointing otherwise. You know,
well, it's a state of mind, and it's a consciousness, and in that consciousness,
yeah,
it's like there's no problem, there's no racism. They didn't make videos. I mean, that's what he's saying. You know, we're not being racist. There's no black people are not making music videos. That's why we're not playing. Okay,
explain why
Sony was threatening to pull all of their Sony artists. And, you know, in order to get Billie Jean played, You know, Rick James was complaining. You know, what is David Bowie talking about? You know what I'm saying? Like, it's real. It happened. And again, like their denial of it, even then they were denying it. They denied it. But listen, it's really plausible deniability is how they function. And they knew they wasn't going to play the stuff. And so they're not going to say, hey, man, we ain't playing that stuff. So they're going to come up with reasons why they don't play it. And as the time, as the clock keeps ticking, the time is not stopping for nobody. And so if I can play a certain amount of music to generate the energy for that music in a period of time, I'm going to get that done. I'll come up with every excuse for the stuff that I don't want to play. You know what I'm saying? It's very simple at what they how they did it and what they do. It's, you know, but fortunately, and that's not just MTV. That's with everything. I'm, you know, again, this was not about attacking MTV. I'm talking about the social system itself. This is the functionality of it. It's the same process. And so, you know, we played it. We played a couple of videos, you know, but they didn't make enough for us to play it. And those responses that, you know, that takes 2 or 3 years for somebody to make a comment. Like, but by that time, 2 or 3 years of artists are gone unseen. Very little promotion. You know, these are the things that people don't realize. Like, this affects people's careers. You know, once the medium changes, you have to be involved in that medium in order to get light. And if you're not, you're going to struggle. And so there it was. You know, people did not know that I did that until they saw the Grammys. Most people had no idea what that was. You see what I'm saying?
And you can see it at that time, too. I mean, when you go back, I mean, like I said, David Bowie is pointing it out. You know, in the video, you can go to MTV News YouTube. I mean, they even posted it a year ago. It says David Bowie criticizes MTV for not playing videos by black artists. So they posted themselves. Yeah. I don't know why Les would be disputing that, you know, but I would love to hear you and him talk, because I think that would be a much-needed debate.
I would love to talk to him. He's not
conversation.
And he's done great things, and it's just a moment in time where it was a situation that we all had to deal with, and some people are in denial of it, and people like myself, I acknowledge it. And I'm, you know, hey, listen, this happened, and we should discuss it because we don't want this to keep happening. Because look what it's done. Look at the damage that it does to all of us. You know, as far as creativity and learning from the masters who came before us and things like that. You know what I'm saying? But here's something that's pretty interesting. he made a comment in the letter he wrote about, you know, we won 5 MTV awards for Rocket. You know, but that doesn't. Says that, but doesn't see the point. If Herbie was in the video completely, and we wouldn't have won 5 MTV awards. You see what I'm saying? There's Caucasian mannequins in the video. That's it. That's why it won 5 MTV awards. That's the point. You see what I'm saying? And he's going, "Hey man, what are you complaining about? You won 5 MTV." Listen, man. Look at why the video won.
Yeah.
Yes, it was very creative and very creative. Again, and I'm not trying to attack Les at all. I'm pointing something out that actually occurred. This actually occurred. And there's 2 ways of looking at it right now. And I'm trying to get him to, you know, hey, bro, go to the middle a little bit so you can understand why I'm saying what I'm saying. I know why you're saying what you're saying. I get it. I understand it. But there's also more information. There's other minds and other consciousness that had to deal with that. And that's where the conversation is needed. And that's why we had that that's why we I brought that up on the last interview, because that occurred. And again,
yeah.
Remember, we were talking about a whole bunch of stuff. You just asked me that question. I said, man, truthfully, this is what happened. And this is how I dealt with the success of Rocket. It was a bit of a sweet thing.
I just asked you about the mannequins. I thought it was an innovative video. That's why, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, it was all robotic. You didn't see nothing else like that in 1983 to that magnitude, you know?
And then I wondered
why Herbie wasn't in there that much. He was just on a monitor, and where the hell was DXT with the scratching? I would have liked to have seen you scratching instead of a dummy kick its fucking legs every once in a while. You know what I mean?
Well,
mix it up a little bit.
Well,
that's what I was wondering.
Just think about that. You know, that was the first time something like that was ever done. You know, I was the only human being in the known galaxy doing that. So wouldn't you think that this is something, hey man, this should be, people should see what this young guy is doing. This is incredible.
Yeah.
That moment was lost, because it would have scared white people.
Yeah, it would have scared the white kids. Actually, the dummies running around with no control scared the shit out of me more than anything.
Right. So they didn't want to scare white kids in Middle America, and so it didn't happen. So there was no, you know, and that's what happened. That's insane, but that's what happened. But what happened when they finally saw it on the Grammys? Look what happened.
Yeah.
You know, today turntable are outselling guitars.